both individually and as a whole, need to take place before we can achieve bigger goals, such as global happiness. So it may be that you're not so familiar with the Thai Sangha, but in general, often, I think, you know, as monastics, we share similar challenges, and there are always similar things which we need to improve or adjust. So perhaps from the Tibetan perspective, you could maybe share something in terms of improving yourselves, or what advice you would have for us, what you know, what you've heard maybe. How can we improve ourselves in order to achieve these bigger goals which we share? So I'm not sure who would like to start, or who should I invite to start? Rinpoche?
This question, any of us cannot answer, because we do not know what are the shortcomings in the Thai Sangha. We are short-time visitors in Thailand, and I visited Thailand for 5 times. For a few days, 5 days, 6 days, 7 days, something like that. And I had the experience of residing in the monasteries. I have a great admiration. We thought Thai Sangha is in a very good shape as far as the practice of Vinaya is concerned. And we also have a great appreciation to the Thai lay people. Among the Buddhist countries of I know, the Thai lay people are most respectful to a Sangha. And any monk can lead a very strictly monastic life depending on alms given by the laity, and you need not worry for anything. And the Buddhist monk has also support from the state, from the various cooperations. So therefore, we have appreciation of Thai Sangha and also Thai lay people. But yesterday, in the course of discussion, some speaker has mentioned that Thai lay community also not very good and they need improvement. So that is your self-criticism, and that's good. Everybody should introspect and look what are the shortcomings. As a Buddhist community, you should check. Otherwise, we are from outside, we cannot offer any suggestion. And also, when we talk with the Thai monks, they do have a lot of criticism for the present Sangha. But of course, we just hear those criticisms, and on that basis, we cannot offer any suggestion. Basically, what Buddha has said to the monks, Buddha has said very clearly in Dhamma Vinaya that the people who have given up a household and entered into a purposeful life, they have only two jobs, to study or to meditate. And there's no any third job a monk should do. So therefore, in case there is a liking in this responsibility of a monk, then of course you yourself should improve, do study and do meditate, and the objective of becoming monk is to inspire for Nirvana. Therefore, whatever you do within the 24 hours, there should be Nirvana-oriented, not worldly-oriented. And in that case, then the Sangha become a kind of a real Buddhist Sangha. Anyhow, I appreciate you ask the question, and but we do not have any suggestion to offer. But Dipankar Shirjan has said when he was in Tibet that in Vikramshila, the Sangha need to take any decision, they come to in the assembly together and they discuss whether this is in accordance with the Dharma Vinaya or it is not in accordance with the Dharma Vinaya. Then the Vinaya holders will discuss, yes, it is in accordance to the Dharma Vinaya, then we should do it. If says no, I have doubts whether this decision would be in accordance with the Dharma Vinaya, then we should postpone it or we should more discuss. So similarly, the criteria of checking the things are the Dharma Vinaya. Buddha had said, when I passed away, this Vinaya is not only your Shastra, but it will be your Shastra, your guidance, your teacher. So we shall have to rely on that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Dorje Damdu, please.
Respected venerables, in fact, I have not really suggestions. It is my thought. Keeping in mind that the laities of Thai is really amazing at the moment in terms of the devotion to the Sangha members. But the question is, how long will it last? This is the next question. So now we see that the world is going in the trend, in a different trend, a trend of paying importance on education. So when the Sangha, when the laities, they turn out to be more and more educated in terms of Buddhist concepts, then if the Sangha members remain as what they are, the earlier times, then the respect towards the Sangha members can happen in the future. So therefore, I'm not saying, you know, by no means, for example, there are so many good things about the Thai Sangha members, really praiseworthy in terms of observing ethical discipline, in terms of meditation and so forth. So, trying to catch up with the world in terms of the modern education, in terms of the sophisticated Buddhist philosophy, I think that is required in order to maintain the state of esteem and the respect that the Sangha members are receiving at this moment. So to make sure that this is happening, and to not to lag behind the lay people's education, the exposure to the Buddhist philosophical concepts, making sure that it's maintained. There must be equal emphasis on the sophistication of the Buddhist studies. So this is simply my idea. Thank you.
Thank you, Geshe. Tomorrow we'll be coming to Tibet House. You can start our education with some advice tomorrow morning. Thank you very much.
Anyone else?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, maybe I could just shift a bit towards meditation practice. It's something we didn't talk about before. And a lot of there's a big increase and upsurge in interest in meditation now, especially in Thailand and the laity, as well as the monastic sangha. Now, the specific question we had from somebody was regarding what we call satipatthana, which is the four foundations of mindfulness. In our tradition, this is said to form the basis of our practice. In fact, almost the whole path is, and the Gaya, body, Vedana, feelings, Citta, mind, and Dhamma, phenomena, mental phenomena, one translation. So just as a general question, and the mindfulness in daily life is obviously a very, very relevant application, and His Holiness teaches it, people studying it in Thailand. So could you just give us some explanations or examples of how mindfulness practice, whether as a formal meditation practice or mindfulness in daily life, is taught or practiced in the Tibetan tradition or the Nalanda tradition, we should call it. And perhaps both for monastics and for lay people, it's very relevant.
The meditation on mindfulness, the term mindfulness itself is a little bit tricky, because nowadays it is being used in a very wide sense, whereas sati, anusmriti in Buddhist technical application, it has a very particular kind of meaning, and which is to be used in a particular sense during the meditation, meditation session and meditation practice. These days, mindfulness, is being used in a very general context, and there are many, as I said yesterday, there is mindfulness-based stress reduction and mindfulness-based attention deficiency, treatment, and things like that. So these kind of mindfulness are being used in a very wider sense. But in a technical sense, the satipatthana and other meditations that we have in our Buddhist traditions, either it is in the Theravada tradition or it is in the Mahayana tradition, the satipatthana is one of the basic and fundamental, practice and practice of meditation. So mindfulness is, if we use mindfulness for sati or anusati, then that is a particular kind of practice during a particular context, right? So, for example, at the time of developing shamatha, during that very process, there is anusmriti to be used, to be utilized as one of the component. Not the entire exercise is called anusmriti, but anusmriti is a particular kind of element in the whole exercise of meditation. So therefore, anusmriti and also the kaya anusmriti, dhamma anusmriti, there are many anusmriti meditations that is also followed in Theravada tradition and also in the Mahayana tradition, which is extremely important in terms of meditating on our own body, meditating on the dhamma, and meditating on our breath and things like that, so which are extremely important. And meditation mindfulness in daily life is very important, to be mindful of whatever we are doing, whatever we are thinking, and that is why the meditation on mindfulness has become very popular these days. And in our traditional, from the traditional point of view, to be mindful while we are walking, to be mindful while we are alone, to watch our own thought process and things like that, that itself is a very important and also very extremely useful in our daily life. And of course, in a technical usage or in technical practice of meditation also, anusati practice is extremely important to be developed. And this is one of the you know, one of many, you know, kinds of practices in Buddhist traditional, you know, practice that through the development of Satipatthana, there is, one can advance to a high level of, advancement through which one can attain, certain spiritual, levels and realizations. Professor Samten has very rightly mentioned the problem of language. I'm in agreement with him. There's no need to answer one question by two persons, but the question is related to meditation. We should dialogue on this little bit further. The term meditation in English language is very loose term. It can be put in a number of different connotations, and in the Buddhist tradition, unfortunately, I don't know what are the Pali terminology, but in Sanskrit, the bhavana, shruti, chintan, and bhavana, these three stages. Shruti is learning and listening.
Sutamaya.
Yeah, sutamaya parjan, shruti maya parjan, chintamaya parjan. Then bhavana. Bhavana is referred to what we generally call the meditation. Now, meditations are not only one kind. They are generally, we can categorize in three different categories. Three different categories means one category of meditation, which is training of mind. The mind shall have to be inculcated in certain certain position or certain mindset. For example, I am meditating Maitri Bhavana, Karuna Bhavana. Maitri and Karuna is not an object on which you are concentrating, but you are meditating on Maitri and Karuna to transform your mind in the nature of Maitri Bhavana, in the nature of Karuna Bhavana. This kind of transforming the mind by analytical meditation, that is one category of meditation. The second category of meditation is to put the mind on one object, that is in the process of achieving shamatha. Concentrative mind is very difficult to achieve. For that, you have to choose one avalamban, what is
one? Aramana, one meditation object.
Yes.
Arum kamatan.
Yes. And after deciding your own avalamban or the object, then you have to concentrate without any distraction, without any thinking. There are two great obstacles. Sometimes your mind loses the object and scattered around, and sometimes you are on the object but you are thinking, not very clear. So for that, then sampragyana and anusmrit, these two are the main instrument to guide your mind from scattering or thinking.
Excuse me, sampajanya and anusati.
Yes, anusati, that's right. Now, sometimes the mindfulness is used for the substitute of anusmriti, and sometimes it is used for sampragyana, and sometimes it is even used for concentration. So, the mindfulness, where we are using, we shall have to be very careful about that. So this concentrative meditation is another kind of meditation. The third category of meditation is visualization. Visualization meditation is mostly in the Tantrayana practice, the Vajrayana practice, but even in Paramitayana also, we have a meditation of Midhuvala Karsugrin. Ugliness.
Asupa Kamatham.
And Apriya, then also we visualize the transitoriness, visualizing the dead body, visualizing the decayed body, in order to reduce the attachments and the raga. So this kind of visualizing meditation is also sometimes used in a paramitayan or in a common meditation. So these are the three different transformation of mind, cultivating the mind meditation, concentrative nature of meditation, and then also visualizing the meditation. So all these three can be again categorized in two categories, that is analytical meditation and concentrative meditation. Analytical meditation, later on, according to the Sanskrit tradition, later on it is it become part of Vipassana, and concentrative meditation later on it develops into the Samatha, and the Samatha and Vipassana is basically, Vipassana is analytical meditation and the Samatha is concentrative meditation. So both of these are equally important in both things. Then the four Anasimit meditation is only one category in the 37 Bodhipakti Dharmas, and there are many different ways of meditation is still there. And in the Sanskrit tradition, we begin from the Kaya Anasimit, the body.
Body contemplation, Kaya Anupasana.
And that is to watch the body and how it is composed of many elements, and then Kaya Anusmriti is to realize the transitoriness of body and how the body is composed, and also body is not the self, not me. All these are included in the Kaya Anusmriti. Then you go to the Vedana. The Kaya is the gross form, and Vedana is something more subtle, and when you go to the Vedana, and then you go to the Chit, the mind, how the mind is operating, and all these three are preparing you to get into the Dharma Anusmriti. The Dharma Anusmriti is the real instrument to eradicate the kleshas and the source of kleshas, the defilements and the source of defilement, the avidya, the ignorance. And when you enter into the Dhamma Anusmriti, then the analyzing the nature of all phenomena, and analyzing the nature of all phenomena, you will realize the Niratma. In the Theravada, I don't know, there is a differentiation between Putugal Niratma and Dharam Niratma. In other Nikayas, we divided into Putugal Niratma and dharam dharatma, the selflessness of the person and the selflessness of the you are not sure, I don't know. Yeah. So anyhow, the fourth meditation is the real mark by which the kleshas, rag, dvesh and moh, this can be eradicated on the meditation of the Dhamma Anusmriti. This is how we understand the practice of the 37 Bodhipaksha Dharmas. Of course, in a few hours or few minutes, we cannot talk about the vast subject of meditation, but I thought just give a hint of how the meditative practice goes on.
Yes, thank you very much, Rinpoche, also Geshe.
Samdong Rinpoche, may I ask a follow-up question on meditation? Last night, there was a question from a Thai monk during the evening sessions that we had. And one of the Thai monks asked Samdong Rinpoche about the use of noise in your meditation. Tibetan practice of meditation seems to use a lot of, you know, chanting as part of the meditation practice. For the benefits of the people at large, may I ask the same question?
I am not a meditator, I must confess. So therefore, I cannot give answers to the questions relating to meditation. I just mentioned before, because I have studied the method of meditation, I have not meditated. So my knowledge is only the knowledge acquired from study, shruti mai pragyan, not chintan mai pragyan. So therefore it is not very reliable. Basically, many sutras, the noise is considered to be greatest enemy of concentration, the meditation. For the beginners, it is advised, there are a lot of preparations for meditation. Environment, place of sitting, and other necessary articles, food, drink, sleep, all these things shall have to be regulated, and then dividing into the meditative sessions and non-meditative sessions, and among them to find a place which does not have disturbance of noise. Noise pollution is considered to be, in Tibetan language we say something is srimane, driving base. The noise is just like a throng to preach to the concentrative mind. This is in general. But there are stages. The music, the chanting, and the natural sounds of river, or the waves of ocean, and the wind. There are so many natural sounds and unnatural sounds. Produced sounds or natural sounds. All this can be converted into as a facility for meditation or object meditation. These are different methods, and I think this can be used when your meditative mind's status goes quite high and you have the ability to concentrate on the object, even there are noise. Then at that stage, you can use the noise for meditation. Now, there is some basic principles why the sound should be converted into an object or a facility for meditation. Because the restlessness of mind is the present situation. The object meditation is to eradicate the status of restlessness and to become stable mind and peaceful mind has to be achieved from the meditation. Sound. Today, His Holiness briefly in Tibetan language asked the monks how the sound arises. What is the principal cause of sound? Sound, in accordance with the Sankhya philosophy, they consider the sound is permanent, nitya. It is a quality of the space, the akash. And therefore it remains in the space and it can be retrieved whenever you want. So it does not decay. But the Buddhist says, no, sound is absolutely impermanence, and the sound does not have a continuity. I just produce a sound and it stopped here, and there's no continuity of my past sound. But how sound, a noise, came into being? There are many cause and conditions. Some force, some moment, and some shape, form, and some moment of energy, and which is combined by I don't know, prana, lung, so
energy.
A kind of energy. English language has a lot of limitations. A kind of energy and a form and a moment all comes together. For example, this is a form and there's another form and there's a space, and I can make a moment, it produces a sound. And then the cause and the condition of sound, there are so many things are together. And therefore, in the higher higher tantra practices, they pay attention to the energy of the body, and the energy of body has its own sound. Each part of the energy of the body, in the form of as we last night we discussed briefly, in the form of breathe in and breathe out, there is a sound, because there is a touch, there is a movement, and there is a sound. And that sound and the energy are not separable. Of course, they are separate things, but they are inseparable. So therefore, it always goes together. And by controlling the sound, it can affect to the controlling of the energy which is moving within the body or within and without the body. So through which the fabrication. Okay. The elaboration or fabrication of all things can be reduced through the controlling of the sound, something like that. So I think this is the what I'm trying to respond to this question. I know it is not appropriate answer, but I'm just beating the bush around.
That's very interesting to hear the details of this kind of practices, which we generally are not investigating, or we're not in our texts or in our tradition analyzing it to that level of the arising of energy and the creation of sound. We usually start with sound. Do you want to ask something else?
There was another question that came up last night. Many people heard His Holiness saying about happiness many times, but in Theravada Buddhism, we often learn about dukkha, started by talking about dukkha. It came up as a question that what would be the best way to teach Buddhism, particularly to children? Should we teach them about happiness, or should we teach them about dukkha?
Yeah, as we discussed on several occasions, when we translate Dharma into different languages, especially like modern languages like English, then the translators need to be very, very careful. Like me, yeah. And sometimes careless, yeah. So it's really important to not to just try to find an equivalent, you know, but to go into the deeper meaning of that Dharma and try to at least find a word which expresses the closest meaning. And you will also be able to understand if you embark on this art of translation. There, on many occasions, there is a possibility to keep the Dharma term as it is, without trying to translate it. For example, the word Dharma itself, it's very easy even for the foreigners to say it. So then bodhicitta, things like that are now coming in the modern English dictionary. So there are many things like that. I think it's better not to try to translate it. And then there are others which you may have to translate it, but in which case, first of all, try to choose a word which expresses the closest meaning. And then still, if there is a possibilities of confusion, like, for example, for shunyata, people can use nothingness, people can use voidness, people can use emptiness, and so on. So in those cases, there may not be an ultimate solution by just picking up one word, but what is really important is to explain those, at least in the beginning, very clearly. And it is also not fair to say that there is no English, you know, word which completely expresses the meaning of Buddhism, therefore we don't want to use any, you know, word of English. That's also not possible. So it is important to use a word which has less opportunity for misconception and which expresses the closest meaning, and then also to clarify it with a glossary or something. And then gradually people will, you know the meaning of the word emptiness in the Buddhist context. So that, I think, is very important. So therefore, related to this point, yesterday we touched about like Nirvana is happiness. But in many translations we read it as Nirvana is peace rather than happiness. So there also we need to see which one is better, happiness or peace, even if you use the word English. So Rupesh was pointing that in the Pali source, the word happiness is there. Param sukham, param sukham. So anyway, and then many people, like now, for example, when we talk about the Four Noble Truth, it has become almost like a commonplace that everybody uses the word suffering. But many questions have been raised by many scholars whether the usage of this word suffering is a proper word. Because the Buddhist idea behind that, those truths, is not so much about, you know, a very obvious suffering, but it's talking more about a state of dissatisfaction, state of kind of unwholesome state or something like that. So there also, I'm not here to decide anything, but all I'm saying is that we really need to be watchful and careful in using those terms.
You are asking about happiness. I remember an incident, so I wanted to share you, just make a kind of joke. We should not be so serious about talking about happiness or dukkha both. Few months back, I was in Hyderabad. A young lady who seems to be very much perturbed and rushing to me, and with great anxiety, she was asking about how to define the happiness. So I left and I asked her, why you are so worried about to define happiness? She said, I'm just making a research on happiness. So then I told her that it seems that research on happiness give you a lot of unhappiness. Actually, she wanted to find some yardstick, measurement, how to measure and how to quantify a so kind of happiness. There was an economic theory recently developed by the botanists, the national gross happiness. And she was a part of that study, and the national gross happiness, then what is happiness, how to define happiness, and then how to quantify. This year, the growth, the happiness of national growth happiness is in this level. They wanted to make some chart. So percentage and then and kind of what you call the chart. And that is absolutely perhaps impossible.
I think the question was about the happiness and the suffering, right? The dukkha.
Yes, particularly if we want to teach Buddhism to the children, the dukkha is perhaps a difficult concept for children to understand.
I think we should, that depends on the approach. Buddha started with the dukkha because that is the reality. And also Buddha said that we should understand what dukkha is. That is why we have the truth of suffering, right? Dukkha satya. So what is the reality of the dukkha is something that we need to understand, and because that is the reality of life. And Buddha talked not only about the, as Venerable said that, Buddha did not talk about the obvious dukkha, but he talked about the changing dukkha and the subtlest dukkha, which is very pervasive, and which even the gods of high realm who have not, who are not free from cyclic existence, they also have this, pervasive suffering. So Buddha talks about these sufferings, and when we are aware of these sufferings, then we can go why we have these sufferings, what are the origin of sufferings, and when we go to the origin of sufferings, then we understand. When we understand that these origin of sufferings can be, ended with the practice, and can be ended, and there is a cessation, then when we realize that there is a cessation, then with what kind of approach we can cease these sufferings, then that there is the path. So these Four Noble Truths lays down the infrastructure of Buddha's teachings, that he gave for the rest of his entire life. So I think the cessation is the happiness, or happiness, as it is, you know, as Rinpoche said that it is in the Pali, cessation as happiness, right? So, Nibbanam Param Sukhanam. So, if we need to attain that Sukha, you know, that Param Sukham, then what is the method to reach there? And to reach there is the path. And in order to reach there, what we need to do is, if we go, you know, the backwards, then we need to, you know, eradicate the origin of the suffering. And then in order to origin, you know, eradicate the origin, how this, the origin of the suffering, then the origin of the suffering is to be eradicated because we do not need suffering. So these are the, you know, two paths, two set of causes and result, one related to the cyclic existence, one pertaining to the, you know, Nirvana. So once we understand that the essence of the Four Noble Truth, then I think it is only a matter of approach that we need people to make understand that, yes, the suffering is something that we need to get rid of, and we need to attain enlightenment, and in Nibbana, the Param Sukham. So therefore, I think when we teach, it depends on the approach. That if they want more about, you know, the happiness, the listener wants to listen or, you know, hear more about the happiness, then of course, and that is also there in the, you know, the teachings of the Noble Truth. But eventually, we have to address in any way this, you know, the truth of suffering.
Just one short comment before I forget. Because as Venerable Sahib already explained how to go into the subtler level of understanding of suffering and happiness, but another thing that is touching our daily life, I think that was your question, how can we explain about happiness and suffering and so forth. So here I think if we come to a very basic ground, basic reality, I think it's very important to develop this understanding that the whole teaching of the Buddha is based on actual experience, actual reality. So we need to simply tell people that, look, very often you suffer. Very often you are happy, very often you are not happy. Is this true? You have to simply ask these questions. Then of course there will be, normally I ask this question to many people, do you want happiness? Yes, they say, I want happiness. Is it sure that you do not want suffering? Everybody says, yes, Geshe-la, it's true that we do not want suffering. Do you have suffering? Almost everybody says, yes, we have suffering. So therefore, that is there already. These experiences are there already. So what we need to tell them or introduce them is, look, you have suffering. Now you have to see from where these sufferings are coming. Predominantly. I'm using the word predominantly because that suffering or state of dissatisfaction may be due to shortage of money or familiar relation, those things are also possible. But deep down in the line, the main predominant source of such suffering is because your way of looking, your mental outlook, it's very much related to the presence of negative emotions and so forth. Similarly, in the case of experience and happiness also, it may be also related to like material facilities, good relationship and so forth. But at the end of the day, you will find that the real, like, trustworthy sense of satisfaction and happiness can be found by cultivating a balanced, harmonious, positive state of mind. So these things I think we can easily introduce based on ordinary life's experiences.
Can I just add one thing to that? I'd like to really just appreciate Geshe's for keeping, in a sense, the presentation of the Four Noble Truths in the side of explaining dukkha. Not being afraid of that, and I think that's something which, like in Thailand, amongst us, it's important as we try to obviously teach children and the society, and as Thai monks or Prapharang Western monks ordained in Thailand go abroad, it can be tempting to make it more appealing, to popularize Buddhism, and to somehow not trust that the Buddha used terms or he formulated his teachings in a very, very clear way,
between Puttaparthi and Varanasi, formulating, maybe thinking, and really whatever, the presentation we have in the Dhammacakkappavattana Sutta is so crucial that if we leave that behind, I think we're leaving behind a very important foundation, so we can really take this advice to really understand what dukkha means and not just say tuk and say suffering, because that's just not the full picture. We have some more questions which we had. Well, there were some more, but I'll just... Is there anyone here who would like to ask a question just from the floor? Otherwise, we have some that were prepared earlier on.
จะขอเรียนถามเกี่ยวกับที่เมื่อวานนี้นะคะท่านดาลัยลามามีพูดนิดนึงเกี่ยวกับเรื่องของ advice on dying การเตรียมการตายแล้วก็ที่จะมี advice เกี่ยวกับ better living ในลักษณะนี้ค่ะเพราะว่าท่านมีเขียนหนังสือเล่มหนึ่งเกี่ยวกับเรื่องนี้อยากจะถามความคิดเห็นเรื่องนี้นะคะและอยากให้ช่วยแนะนำเพราะว่าการเตรียมตัวการตายหรืออะไรเนี่ยเป็นไงเพราะลักษณะของทิเบตที่มองที่อ่านหนังสือมาบ้างแต่ไม่มากเลยก็คิดว่าจะมีอะไรที่แตกต่างกับทางของพุทธนะคะขอบคุณค่ะ
So the question is His Holiness has spoken on the notion of preparing oneself for a better dying preparing oneself for dying and as a result then creating a better living by using this the awareness of our dying preparation for it so she's asking if you have any comments or observations around it?
For dying. In fact, there are one or two books by His Holiness the Dalai Lama on this question. And I personally feel that, so basically, you know, at the time of death, there's a fear. There's a fear dominating us. So fear is a state of mind. Fear is a state of feeling in us. So another question is there any means by which this fear can be counteracted by another state of feeling? Okay, so we need to look for you know, means in terms of a state of feeling which has the ability to counteract that fear of the death, the state of a feeling. And the state of the feeling, if you look at what kind of state of feeling usually overcomes your fear or insecurity, particularly when you have a very strong feeling of affection towards someone, for example, the children, they feel so secure in front of their parents. So there is a loss of fear, disappearance of the fear. So because of the affection. So now this quality is within ourselves. If there's a seed within us, if we can enhance this compassion, if we practice something which has which is meant to enhance your compassion, to make your general trend of your mind compassionate, then so the feeling which accompanies this compassionate mind is totally fearless. This is one thing. So if you can practice that on a daily basis, then your mind will become stronger and stronger in that sense, and then gradually your natural state of mind can take that state, take that feeling. So even at the time of the death, you think about, you know, the death, but then the compassion, which you have habituated so much, will automatically come in you, and then the feeling accompanying that compassion is a feeling of fearlessness. So this would be a wonderful idea, one. And then particularly in the Buddhism inherited from Nalanda University, there's a tremendous emphasis on the practice of altruism grounded on compassion. So this is one possibility. Then another possibility would be to see everything as dreamlike. To see everything as dreamlike. This is another, not just possibility, this is a very powerful method. So actually it should be, you know, I have no idea about the Thai Buddhist concept. I'd like to learn from you. And then one of the concepts what is known as the four seals of the Buddha's teaching. All composite things are impermanent, all contaminated things are of suffering nature. And the third one, which is everything is of the nature of emptiness and selflessness. So at this part, once you understand that, then the third seal will come into happen, which is transcending sorrow. Then it will transcend the sorrow to achieve a lasting peace. So there is not a matter of, you know, just I need to achieve arahatship right now. No. So if you understand the shunyata level or the anatma, the selflessness concept, if you try to first get a glimpse of it, study that, reflect on it, and then once you get a glimpse of it, then habituate in that practice, then the real fearlessness can happen. Real fearlessness can happen. So even death is a state of a feeling, the fear comes, feeling that this I, which exists so solidly in the form of Atma, it is disappearing. So this is a fear. So once you realize the fact that this Atma is not really there, I exist in the form of a dream life. Once we realize the third seed well, and then accustom your mind, familiarize your mind in that experience, then, you know, this is a direct remedy to the fear. So this is my suggestion. Thank you.
I would like to add one point to this, that in Buddhism, there is in Mahayana Buddhism, and in particularly in Vajrayana Buddhism, there is a practice of, you know, going through the process of death. And that is actually practiced during our meditation sessions in, you know, different practices. So the person who is very well versed in that kind of practice can, you know, who is very adapted to that and very good in that practice, he can go into that process, even the natural death, even before the natural death comes. So therefore, there are, you know, some of very highly realized, you know, practitioners who can, predict their, you know, who can say that they are going to die on that particular date and things like that. So these kind of things are, you know, something that is, a common practice in, you know, Vajrayana practitioners. And there is a general saying that, you know, for general practitioners, when we practice on the death, we familiarize on the death process and familiarize on the occurrence of the death, then we will have less fear about the death. And it is said that the best practitioners will happily embrace the death, and a good practitioner would at least will not fear at the time of death. So therefore, death is something that, you know, that really matters a lot in our life. And the practitioner, it depends on the practitioner themselves, how they tackle the death, and during their daily practice before death, how they, you know, take into their practice to encounter the death.
There's another question at the back. much. I've been thinking a lot about His Holiness's words on doing what we can for ecology and the environment, and also thinking about the state of the global economy today and the way in which we manage to extract wealth at perhaps the cost of natural systems. And so my question is, in some ways, how are we to understand the negative ecological and possibly social consequences of the wealth that we have accumulated, but yet it is the same wealth that allows us to be here today, this excess of resources that allows us perhaps the time to study Dhamma, seems also in some ways to come at the cost of the natural systems of the world more and more, through economy and commerce and through our trade. So how do we find a balance between those, or how do we understand our own role in perhaps making it a better world without necessarily retreating to a little farm in a corner of the world?
I remembered some of the sayings by His Holiness. I would like to repeat those. His Holiness very often mentioned that each and every country thinks about the gross national product increase every year. And His Holiness said this is very, very impractical, because the so-called increase in economical development or GNP of that country, that development has to come from the external natural resources. External natural resources are by definition material physical resources. Physical material resources by definition are limited. So how can you make unlimited development or progress every year from limited resources? The only way you can do that is destroy the external natural resources. So that's what we are already doing. That includes the destruction of the environment and so forth. And then people might, He's already said, people might ask the question, in that case, then how can we judge the standard of living of the people, life of the people? His Holiness answered by saying that the standard of the people can be judged not by whether the GNP of that country is increasing every year or not, but GDP is increasing every year or not, but in terms of their daily livelihood, their income, and when their daily livelihood, income, and so forth are okay, then we should consider things are normal, things are okay. So therefore, His Holiness very clearly mentioned, in order to check all these side effects in the form of environmental pollution, in the form of economical recession, all this can be stopped or reduced if we have a proper understanding of the way things are. And in fact, he told people that in the case of the external material development resources, we are never contented. We want more and more. We want to exploit the nature and more and more, not realizing or not thinking about the fact that the resources are limited. That's our problem. So he said, it's important to understand the fact that external material resources are limited. Therefore, accordingly, we should have some kind of contentment, some kind of plan, not to go endlessly exploiting the natural resources. Then on the other hand, in the case of the internal natural resources, like the spiritual practices and development and so forth, it is unlimited. You can make unlimited progress in terms of your internal, you know, mental resources, but there everybody is satisfied. Hardly anybody makes an attempt to improve those internal mental, you know, mental resources. At the most, we will say, "Oh, this morning I did 10 minutes meditation." Apart from that, we don't do that. So His Holiness strongly advises and suggests that you should make more internal spiritual development, because the resources are unlimited. You can explore to an unlimited, you know, extent. So therefore, in dealing with, there are so many problems, as you have just raised some of the points. So in dealing with all these ills of the society and problems of the society, unless we check within our oneself and reduce some of this greed, as Mahatma Gandhi also joined in the same line by saying, there is enough for everybody's need, but not enough for everybody's greed.
So therefore, like, if we try to come up with kind of patchwork solution, that's what we do in the modern day, that if there's a problem, we try to address only that problem, forgetting the holistic truth and reality. So instead of trying to solve the problem with patchwork solution, it's important to, you know, based on something like the understanding of interconnected, you know, reality and so forth, with a holistic attitude, I think we can deal with many of these problems.
I would like to make some supplementary comments. There are so much material facilities these days, and the questioner says gathering like this, a Dharma dialogue, this kind of thing, we are able to arrange due to the modern facilities. I think this is the wrong way to look at things. Even there have not been this kind of modern facility, the exchange of idea of Dharma can very well happened. If we look back to the time of Ashok and sometime thereafter, during which the Buddhism was very rapidly and very pervasively spread all over the center, south and southeast Asian countries. And at that time there was no facility like today. An Indian scholar who writes important details in Kanyakumari, the southernmost part of India, and the next year, repetitions or comments are coming from the Kashmir, the northmost part of India. This kind of communication systems are always there. And during Buddha's period also, hundreds of thousands of people used to gather to listen to the Buddha's teachings. So therefore, whatever we do today is not due to the availability of the modern facilities. On the contrary, our minds become the slave of modern facilities, and we are conditioned by all the modern facilities, and which reduce the capacity and the strength of human individual a great deal. Today I cannot communicate to my friends without a cell phone, but I was more communicative when the cell phone was not invented. And these things we have to actually I wanted to tell a basic thing, because yesterday and in the night there was several questions come to me, but I was not able to respond to them. In the ancient time, not very ancient time, only 200 years before, 240 years before, the world was not so-called industrialized, and every needs were produced. Every commodities were produced in accordance with the need of the people. And all the need of people were being satisfied by the producers. 250 years before, no one was moving around bare feet. Everybody has a shoe to wear. Everybody has a clothes to wear. Everybody has a food to eat. Then a great change has taken place on this earth. The invasion of machine
the people were able to produce the commodities much, much more than the need of the people. After producing the commodities more than the need of people, then they need the concept of market. And how to marketing these productions, they have very, very cleverly realized that human greed is very easy to exploit. In order to exploit human greed, they find a very effective method, that is comparison. Comparison and competition. Comparison and competition is not a nature of the human mind. It is a conditioning of the human mind from our sources. Right from the childhood, we condition the children's mind not to realize oneself, but to realize oneself by comparing somebody else. The parents used to tell the children, look, that your neighbor is the same age of you, but he is running and you are still crawling. And he is able to read ABC and you are not able to read ABC. By this way, comparative mind is being created, and which leads to competition. And today we have completely lost the capacity, the ability to know what is my need. All your needs are being dictated by you, the producers, on your cost. And you do not know what is your need. And you always say, somebody has this and I must have this. And my neighbor has two cars, I shall have to purchase one more car, whether I need it or not. But it is by comparison and competition. This is an illusion which is forcefully imposed upon us through so many technological instruments, and our mind is now completely diluted by these things. And the television, the print media, all this tells you what you need. And for that you have to work hard to earn the money, and then you earn the money. A few months before, somebody was telling me, a young man worked very hard to earn a certain target of money. And during that hard work, he lost his health. And whatever he earned, the money was being spent in the hospitals to restore his health. But his health was not able to restore, even spending all the money. So by this way, people become very, very, not only insensitive, they are stupid. The entire economic world is most stupid. The real things are not able to, the obvious things are not able to see and not able to realize. The limited resources, everybody knows that resources are limited, but they wanted to use it unlimitedly. And everybody knows the environmental degradation, and particularly global warming. According to the reports of the recent scientists, if we do not have a check, immediately the global warming goes on like this. By 20 years by now, from now, within 20 years, a large portion of land would be submerged under the water. And this is not a prediction by some oracles or by some jyotish. These are the statistics produced by the most accepted scientists. So even then, we are not able to realize, and we are not able to check ourselves. So unless and until we check the mindset of comparison and competition, unless and until we have developed a sense of discriminating what is my need and what is my greed, and to reduce the greed and live with the need, then no one will have any problem. No ecological problem, no economic disparity. Economic disparity is not due to shortage of wealth. Economic disparity is only due to exploitation and the accommodation system which prevents the just and equal distribution of the wealth. So we have to understand this, and we shall have to, each individual, of course, to change the entire world economic system might have taken time, but each individual can feel the universal responsibility and live with a balanced life. Balanced life means a sustainable consumption. Live a usage of the commodities which are really to need, and we are not become a machine of consumption. In a English word, there's a use and a consume. They are two different things. And in Indian language also, upabhog or upayog. Upayog means using, and upabhog means just consuming. We all have been made by the multinational companies and producers just a machine of consuming. And by that way, that there's no end of war and terrorism, because they are the market and the consumers of the weapon industry. And the weapon industry need always a market. And without war and without terrorism, how you can sustain the market? So this is very simple fact, but nobody is willing to look at it and say it, call it a spade as spade. So this is our problem. We shall have to raise to the occasion, and we shall have to change our own lifestyle. And also we should try to change the lifestyle of others.
Samdong Rinpoche, you have given the wisdom for those who are planning to visit Chanakat Market after this conference.
Okay, since the question is, what is the view of His Holiness on this point? So since the Venerable Samdong Rinpoche and my colleagues, they've already stated many points, and I think there are a few points as well. One point that we need to keep in mind, I'd like to make it very short. Number one, His Holiness says we need to have material development. We need to have material development, point one. It's not that, you know, we have to be underdeveloped, right? We need to have material development, one. Then the next question is, up to what level of material development? This is the next question. Then, if we say the world is divided into poor and the rich, and if we are to make all the poor people rich, right, then everyone having a car, so where are the resources coming from? So where's the resources? So there's no adequate resources to have, you know, to give cars to all the, you know, the people on this earth. So this is what His Holiness says, right? So therefore, while we need to have material development, but the point is, to what extent we should also think of the future generation, because the material development happens at the cost of, you know, the material resources. And the excessive extortion of material resources, so what are we going to leave for the future generation? This is another question that His Holiness asks, one. Then, and then at the same time, the problems are there. Why we need material development is to bring about, you know, happiness, to create about happiness on this earth. And then the problem still lies, the gap between rich and poor. This is Holiness wants, you know, is so keen to address wherever he travels. So the gap between the rich and poor, His Holiness's view is that instead of, you know, providing everyone with cars and so forth, better the rich person provides skills to the poor people so that they become self-sufficient as to how not to be, you know, how not to suffer the poverty. And then the another thing is, you know, whatever resources that we already have extracted, so, and for used for material development, so there, how about, you know, recycling? So these are the few things which I would recall from His Holiness's the talks on this issue. Thank you.
There's another question from the floor. Please raise your hand, the microphone is coming to you.
Hello. By the way, we are twins. My name is Kulawe Jain Watanabit. I'm from Young Buddhist Association of Thailand. There's a lot of talk about education, but sometimes the wisdom of nature is so it cannot be communicated through human language. And it's actually not the human language that is the barrier between us. It's just the ignorance. If we put ourselves together as one-year-old children, we will all reach consensus or play together without any problem. How could we work together? How could we work together and go right to the substance without wasting the time on the form? That's my question. Thank you.
Without wasting time, what?
On the form which the is
form.
Like
form.
External, all this thing that is, maybe it's something to do with our culture and we cannot change. But right to the substance of the wisdom of the nature of Buddhism.
When I meet people, so sometimes, just as you have asked, it becomes very crucial, important to relate to some of the fundamental facts. Although in accordance with the Buddha's teaching, but it becomes important to come up with a very convincing fact of the reality of our life. So one of the facts that I normally share with other people and which you also, I think, has briefly mentioned is that Buddha had said that birth is suffering. That's what Buddha said. That's actually a plain fact, but nobody wants to listen to that. Everybody says, happy birthday. Okay? I'm not against anybody celebrating happy birthday, but all I'm saying is at least give some thought to this teaching of the Buddha where he says birth is suffering. So now we need to do our, you know, groundwork and just in an unbiased way see the truth of this teaching. Right after the birth of the child, the first thing that the child does is crying, not laughing, not smiling. If the first thing that the child does is smiling or laughing, then maybe people say, oh, this must be high reincarnation or a ghost. Okay? So now look there. Now again see, by crying, what else the child can do, because he doesn't have a developed language, he's saying something, he's asking for something. But then again you do some experiment. What could that child be asking? Is that child asking for a lengthy discourse on Buddhism or on Christianity or Judaism? I don't think so. The child is simply asking for genuine human affection and care. So now it is on this level, on this ground, that we are all exactly same. Child from Thailand, from China or Tibet or America, well, wherever, the first thing that the child does is cry. Absolutely same on that level. So if you read some of His Holiness's books like Ethics for the New Millennium or the latest book, Beyond Religion, he's really trying to, you know,
make us aware about this basic sameness. He calls it secular ethics, this basic similarity. But unfortunately, as and when we grow up, then we forget that basic sameness, basic, you know, reality, and we come pay more importance to the secondary, superficial things. Then we start talking about from which country you come from, what religion you practice, the second, less pervasive, less important issues, you see, the dividing factors. So therefore, I'm glad that you asked this question. I really don't have to elaborate anything on this point. I will simply urge that you read some of these His Holiness books, Ethics for the New Millennium, Art of Happiness, Beyond Religion. Then also, of course, you can use your own common sense. It's really important for us to understand this very important binding fundamental reality and then learn how to live together, how to walk together.
The responses to that question, how to go directly to the heart. It's very clear.
If I may ask a follow-up question to the question that was raised earlier. This morning, when in the presence of His Holiness, we asked for His guidance as to what the Tibetan and the Thai sides could work together after this conference ends. And we receive a lot of good guidance on how we can work together to strengthen relationships among, you know, Tibetan Buddhisms and Theravada Buddhisms on Buddhist activities. This afternoon, our discussions has also gone into other issues like ecology, global warming, social issues, income disparity. Is there any issue that you think about, and is there any social issue that we should also think of cooperation between the Tibetan and the Thai side?
I think it is not only a matter of cooperation between Thai Buddhism and Thai Buddhism and Tibetan Buddhism, but in general, you know, world citizen and religious people and Buddhist people, and in particularly the Thai Buddhists and the Tibetan Buddhists, can do a lot to contribute to the, you know, problems of the world by bringing awareness and by educating people through various means. And with such a collaboration, I think there are many ways through which we can bring up, you know, activities, and through which we can educate people in various ways so that people may become more aware of the problems and the solutions, you know, for those problems, and then, you know, bring those solutions in their real life and make the society more happier. So I think there are lots of things that can be done.
Any other questions from the floor?
อนุญาตถามภาษาไทยนะครับ
ได
้อยากทราบว่าประเทศที่ใช้ธรรมะนะครับเป็นหลักใช้หลักการหรือว่าแนวความคิดของธรรมะเนี่ยฮะในการบริหารประเทศเนี่ยเหมือนอย่างที่คล้ายๆที่ทิเบตเป็นอยู่เนี่ยครับก็จริงๆฟังดูดีเพราะว่าพัฒนาด้านจิตวิญญาณหรือว่าจิตใจเป็นหลักนะฮะแต่ว่าในเมื่อเรามองดูโลกใบนี้ที่เราเป็นประเทศนึงและถูกแวดล้อมด้วยประเทศอื่นๆที่พัฒนาทางด้านวัตถุแล้วก็มีความโลภมีความกระหายในอำนาจนะฮะอยากที่จะยึดครองอยากที่จะเอาเปรียบกดขี่ประเทศที่ด้อยกว่าอยู่เสมอแบบนี้เนี่ยฮะในความเป็นจริงประเทศที่ใช้ธรรมะเป็นหลักการในการปกครองประเทศเนี่ยฮะสามารถจะอยู่ได้ในโลกใบนี้ยังไงครับเพราะว่าประเทศที่เน้นทางด้านวัตถุเนี่ยก็พัฒนาเทคโนโลยีต่างๆมากขึ้นเรื่อยๆแล้วก็ยิ่งมีอำนาจมากขึ้นเรื่อยๆในการที่จะกดขี่ประเทศที่เน้นทางด้านจิตใจเพราะฉะนั้นถ้าเราเป็นประเทศแบบนั้นเนี่ย เราจะอยู่ยังไงในโลกใบนี้ครับขอบคุณครับ
So that the question is this morning there was a question for His Holiness about Buddhist principles what have been brought into public policy in Tibet so the idea that there may well be a country may well govern itselfbased on Buddhist principles and emphasize the development of the mind or happiness, then this is a wonderful thing. There may well be such countries. But given that such a country would be surrounded by other countries more motivated or driven by forces such as greed and anger, which would usually drive that country or fuel that country to control, to dominate its neighbors, could such a...The Buddhist-oriented country, the peaceful country, the contented one, is that sustainable? Can that survive in such an environment?
I think your question is a very important and relevant question which Buddhist nations, Buddhist countries have not paid proper attention until now. At many times I used to admire and appreciate Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi.On only one reason, the teaching of non-violence, teaching of love and compassion is so ancient, more than 7,000 years recorded history in India, the teaching of non-violence, teaching of compassion in mind exist.And particularly in Buddha's teaching, non-violence was the center. One side non-violence, the other side compassion. The two sides of one coin, so to speak, that was the essence of Buddhism. Acharya Ayadevi have said, if someone asked me to sum up Buddha's teaching into one word,I would say non-violence. But all the Buddhist countries could not realize a nation can remain completely non-violent. In the management of state, in the management of governance of a nation, of a country, violence become a kind of unavoidable. Tibet remain Buddhist country since 8th century. The Buddhism reached there until now. We always say the combination of Dharma and polity. But the Tibet governance system could not eliminate the armed force.Could not eliminate some system of punishment, which are quite cruel. They argue that in order to maintain state management, law and order, we have to do some kind of indulge into some kind of violence. And similarly, Thailand, Myanmar, Sri Lanka, these are also.For quite some time, Buddhist country, but these Buddhist nations could not do away with the military force, do away with the police, do away with the system of legal system of punishing the criminals, some kind of cruelty. Nobody had the realization, a national moment of independence, of freedom, reconstruction of a nation, or defense of a nation, can be carried out through complete nonviolence. And this was for the first time Gandhi has demonstrated, not only preached, but practiced. Of course, after departure of Gandhi, the Indian nation did not follow what Gandhi is teaching. Otherwise, Gandhi has a concept of a forceless nation. National defense, whatever aggressive neighbors they might be, India might be surrounded by all aggressive nations, but India can survive without military force, without any arm. And the concept of non-violent national defense, concept of non-violence, national struggle for freedom and justice, all this can be done through non-violence. Therefore, his contribution in practice of non-violence in the affairs of state management, governance of a nation, governance of a country, there can be total non-violence method can be adopted. And his theories were, if someone experimented, they are very practical. So, therefore, in future, Tibet could regain its freedom, or its autonomy, or its independence, whatever it may be, then we are able to educate the masses, the entire Buddhist principles and teachings, and practice it. I'm completely confident that whatever the neighbors might be, powerful, aggressive, and all kind of the demerits are there, we can defend ourselves through complete non-violence. Gandhi had said during his freedom struggle, if I could get 100 people who are qualified for satyagraha means to resist non-violently, not only physical non-violent, with complete compassionate mind, he said he can bring India's independence within 24 hours. And it was not a joke. It was not an irresponsible statement. He had made this statement after full consideration of all these things. But unfortunately, during that time, he could never had 100 people who were well qualified for satyagraha. Now the question shall have to answer from two angles. If you are asking, if we adopt completely Buddhist way or non-violent way, can we survive amidst of the all violent and aggressive nations around? I would say definitely we can survive if we are non-violent, if we are matured into mind of compassionate. Then this question is looking from the different angle. Will you able to make the nation matured in the compassionate mind and non-violence? Then there is doubt. If there is the slightest violence mind is remaining there, then of course we shall not be able to stand out or to protect ourselves through non-violent way. I myself saying that if there are 10 Tibetan people who are really matured in a compassionate mind to everyone and particularly to the Chinese rulers, I do not believe that China can rule over Tibet like today. Due to great leadership of His Holiness for the last around 44 years, the Tibet movement remained completely physical, non-violent. There's no physical violence inside Tibet or outside Tibet. That is also a great achievement, and due to which the Tibet issue did not disappear from the face of the globe. Otherwise, Tibet is so tiny, and it's not an important question. But the entire world community had to care for the Tibet issue because of our physical nonviolence. If we become really mentally nonviolent, the majority of the Tibetan people mentally nonviolent and free from anger or hate to the Chinese rulers, I'm sure they will not be able to do as they are doing today. So therefore, to mature a large scale of population as a nation to become a mentally non-violent and full of compassionate, that is difficult. If that is able to achieve, then of course the Buddhist principles are self-supportive and self-sufficient. I have no doubt no one can destroy this.
Yes, I think we are running out of time. We have to bring this question, this session to the end. I have to ask Dr. Bancha to say the final words.
Samdong Rinpoche, most venerable Geshe, and all our Tibetan friends, Pukun Jiao, and Tan Pu Khao Ruom, น่าจะสมควรแก่เวลาเพราะเราได้ใช้เวลาอย่างเต็มกำลังเพื่อธรรมะ I just informed that we already utilized the two whole days for Dhamma to be understand and also for further work that on behalf of Buddhasasa Itapanyo that archive that Your Highness Samdong Rinpoche suggests that should be the responsibility of this, because when we request Samdong Rinpoche for this, we already discussed and we think that it should be done, something should be done, and this is already done. So further works will be worked out. I learned that almost all of us here come to see me and say that anything they can join hand with us. So almost all, not only the monk and those lay who are in the practitioner, but also the businessman, I'm sure that, because here we bring several groups of friends. We have two or three chairperson of the leading banks of the country. We bring even the CEO of the stock market to be here. We also have several families, and they feel very happy and would love to join what is going will be coming soon. As I already mentioned, that the Thai Health Promotion now that intensify in spiritual health, also would love to support the project between Thai and Tibet, because of the board of trust to several boards is here. The vice chairperson of that organization also is here. So I would like to thank you very much for your compassion for us, and thank you for all. I think it's time to leave. Man, where is I just said, oh, there's the box there. มีกล่องอยู่ตรงนั้นพี่อ้อได้ไหมหรือใครช่วยยกมาให้หน่อยที่จะได้ถวายให้กับพระคุณเจ้าทั้ง5รูปคุณหญิงสุภัตราช่วยอยู่ตรงนี้ให้พวกผมใช้ก็ช่วยใช้ทุกใช้ต่อไปนะครับ Momentos is some books fromBhujadasa archive, but the reproduction of the Thangka that His Holiness joined in preparing this. เราควรจะจบด้วยการสวดมนต์สักนิดหนึ่งนะฮะก็เอาสามอย่างก็ช่วยนำ
Final chanting. Arahang Samma Sambuddho Bhagava Buddhang Bhagavantang Abhivadeni Sawa